I like that song.
Amen.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Amen. Well, glory. I feel like we're just holding back a little bit.
Lord.
I feel like we're tired or something. In the name of Jesus. I'm going to preach for just a few minutes. I promise I'll try not to bore you too long. But I'm going to preach for just a few minutes. Try to finish up what I was talking about this morning about enacting the vision. This morning I talked to you for just a little bit about the last few weeks about are you ready for this and follow me.
CD.
Talked to you the last few weeks about enacting the vision and what God would have us to do and stepping into the unknown and seeing what God would actually do for us. Removing the limits off of God.
Amen.
Taking the law of the lid off. Taking the limitations that we put on God and say, okay, God, I can believe you for salvation, but I can't believe you for anything else. I can't believe you for miracles in my body, but I can believe you for salvation. I taking the limits off, just taking the lid off of what Jesus can really do. What can God really do in your life if we just remove all of our prejudices and our preconceived notions of what God is and who He is and all those things. If we could just for a second remove ourselves from what we think God really is and seeing what He actually is.
Amen.
Removing ourselves away from all the doubts that's been placed inside of us and all the discouragement that's been placed inside of us, the so-called unanswered prayers and the times we feel like we've been rejected by God. And what can God really do if we truly, truly, truly remove the limits off God and say, God, I'm just dumb enough to believe you're able to do what you say you can do.
Amen.
So this morning I began to preach that and ask if you're engaged. Have you engaged yourself? Have you gotten involved in what God's doing? Have you actually gotten involved in what? Have you caught the vision of this house? Have you gotten involved in the vision of this house? Are lost souls important to you? How many know who Darlene Bishop is? That's what I thought. Darlene Bishop is a man. She's about this tall. I'm not exaggerating. But that woman can just flat out preach. She always wears these heels that are this long, and she's still this tall. And she just, that woman can just throw down. I'm just telling you. And I was listening to a sermon of hers the other day, and I was listening to what she had to say, and she just gets me fired up. Okay. And she does. That woman can just throw down, man. I'm telling you. She can preach. And not even, I mean, she's just a little country girl from Monroe, Ohio, and she just... Her husband died about 3 or 4 years ago, and they started this church. Her husband was a cowboy, and her son's a bull rider, and all this stuff. And somebody you wouldn't think I would even connect to, but that lady, I mean, she began to preach about the lost souls of humanity. And I said, "Go ahead, Jeff Nance, preach it," because she preached almost word for word what I had been preaching in the prior months. About seeking the lost souls of humanity, about reaching out and doing something that we can, that God is greater than our ability to even think or imagine, that God is able to do things that we've not ever thought He could do, that God would reach out into the lost souls and change their lives. And you know, people always say, well, I was born that way. And one of the statements she made is, she said, as I was witnessing to a young man who said, I was born this way. She said, that's why you got to be born again.
Amen.
And I thought that was pretty sticking good. That's why we must be born again, because we're born into sin and to depravity, and we're all lost and dying, whatever sin it was in your life. But she said that statement stuck with me, that that's why we have to be born again. It's because we were born into sin, the Bible states. We're all born lacking. We're all born needing God. We're all born into a sinful nature. We're all born that way, and so we needed to be born again. I don't care what your sin was or what your problem was. You needed to be born again. And so I ask you to please get hold of the vision of this house, and the vision of this house are souls.
Amen.
Souls.
Amen.
Not cars. Not trucks and mobile homes and I don't care, whatever it is. But souls.
Amen.
And 5 people came forward this morning and they just did my heart good. And now we have to cultivate those 5. Because I don't see any of them here. Is there Wesley? But I don't see Zane, and I don't see the 3 girls. And the 3 girls, I know they need to get a ride to church, and they can't always come and all that stuff. But Zane's not here this evening. I love Zane. Zane's great. Today's Zane's birthday. He turned 50 today. He turned 50 today. It's Donald's brother-in-law. It's Donald's brother-in-law. He needs to be cultivated. He needs to be discipled. He needs to have somebody love him.
Amen.
Amen. And share the gospel with him. And so does Wesley and the 3 girls that came down today. They all need somebody to care for them and love them and cultivate that thing in their life. Because if they don't, they're going to fade away. They're going to fade away. So as I was saying this morning, the vision is to take the limits off of God, to find ways to touch the city. We'll never touch the city by sitting around saying somebody ought to do that. It's not going to happen. It's going to fall on somebody. The mantle of God's going to fall on somebody. God's going to pour out His Spirit in the last days like He's never done before. And how many believe we're in the last? I believe it. All that's in me, we're in the last days of this thing. Oh, they've been saying that. Listen, I know they've been saying that. But now it could actually happen. Now the technology is there for everything to happen, just as the Bible said. Now the technology is there to put a chip in your hand or your forehead and you can buy or sell. Now the technology, listen, they said by 2017, every credit card you have will have a chip in it that you have to, like the smart cards, whatever, that you know, at Walmart, you have to wait behind everybody because the thing doesn't work right. Mm-hmm. Then you slide your card in and it doesn't ever work correctly. And so you have to wait. And so, but 2017, that's a year and 3 months away. Y'all have been saying that for years. Listen, I know that. And I don't plan on being here for the Antichrist. I don't care who it is. I don't care if he's the third toe of the 8th beast with the 4th crown. I don't care who he is. It doesn't matter to me. I'm going to be gone.
Amen.
I don't care if the mark of the beast is a chip in your hand or the right on with a magic marker. I don't care what it is. It doesn't matter to me. I don't care because I don't plan on being around, and it doesn't. But I don't want lost humanity to be here either. I want the Antichrist to be here by himself and rule his own kingdom by himself. I want everybody to go to heaven. Amen. So we got to find ways to win the loss of the city. We got to find ways to get hold of the things of God. We got to find ways. And I said this morning, I have to have leaders who are strong in faith, not loud in prayer, but strong in faith.
Come on.
Let y'all catch that in a minute. I don't care how loud you pray. What do you say? It may be under your breath. Now, there's been a lot of those little quiet ladies and quiet men that have a lot more faith than those guys screaming and hollering.
Amen.
Well, you can get upset with me if you want to, but it's the truth. I've been in church a long time.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of folks put on a show. And there's some that have something inside of them. There's some folks you can go to with anything. And they'll never tell a soul. And there's some you can't even tell your shoe size. Everybody knows. I'm just letting you know. Now, I need leaders that are strong in faith, knowledgeable of the Word of God. That is one most people aren't. Well, that preacher said this, and that preacher said that. Yeah, but what did God say? Well, I don't know exactly.
Yeah.
What about this book? What about the 66 books in this Bible?
Amen.
What about this thing? What about this? What about this Bible that God has given us? I was talking to Brother Ledbetter, who pastored Paul's Valley he's pastored there years and years and years. He's 80-something years old. He's still pastoring that church in Paul's Valley. He said, I've slowed down, Brother Jeff. I said, oh, yeah? He said, I used to read the New Testament every week, and now I don't quite get through it all the way. The whole New Testament. Every week. That was on top of reading his other stuff and studying for sermons and studying for the things of God. But he would read the entire New Testament every week. Where are those men at? They're dying. They're dying, and we're going, I got it on my phone. I can look up anything I need. And I can. But where are those men that know chapter and verse? Where are those men and women, I should say, that know exactly where to find something in the Word of God? They don't have to hold somebody. They don't have to do like I do, Brother Dean. Now, Brother Dean, find that scripture for me. Then I need to use it. That was Wednesday night. So I'm not saying that I'm Mr. Perfect. I'm just asking you a question. Where are those men who are knowledgeable of the Word of God and women? Where are those that are able to lead without being a jerk? Where are those that love people? Lead by serving. Where are those men and women at? Where are those that lead without malice? Where are those that minister the Word of God out of love and compassion and not out of hurt and pain and you better do what I say, boy. But this is what God's Word says, and if you want to have a blessed life, this is what you need to do. Where are those that are compassionate for those who are seeking after God and not judgmental after those that are failing and not doing everything they're supposed to do right? Listen, we have, I don't know if you know this or not, but there's several people in the church. Listen to me. There's several people in the church that are struggling and they have things that are going on in their lives. And do you care? I'm asking you, do you know what I'm talking about? Do you understand that there are several that are hurting? There's several that are having a hard time making it from just Sunday to Wednesday. So my question is, are you calling them? Are you checking on them? Listen, I'm not a Facebook pastor. I'm not going to post my stuff off for everybody to see. See? For those that, he don't even care. I don't post my stuff for everybody to see. Because it's none of your cotton picking business. What I have to say to somebody about something. It's not that I don't care. It's just that I don't care to put it on Facebook. I love Facebook. It's a way to hang out and just do stuff. I don't have any malice for Facebook. But I don't need to know you had to go to Bronze because Cazadores was full. I don't care. I don't care. I just don't care. It just makes my phone ding. Listen, we're enacting the vision. We're enacting the vision that God has given me. I'm just going to move toward it. I don't want you to be upset with me. I don't want you to be upset about anything. I want you to be happy and I want you to just get in control of what God's doing and get a hold of what God's doing. I want you to get in control of your mind and don't let the devil play in your head. But this is your mind and you're supposed to have a sound mind. You're supposed to have a sound mind, not to all confused. And the devil's easy to confuse because he's the author of confusion. So you need to confuse the devil by when he gets doubt in your mind, you say, I doubt that doubt. And then the doubt messes up his mind because he's the author of confusion. So mess with him a little bit when he messes with you. So let me just share something with you. That God himself is looking for somebody. It'll simply sell out. How many times have I preached it? 100 times? I don't know how many times I've preached it. But we're enacting the vision. I'm just going to go for it. I don't know what else to do but just go for it. I can't wait any longer. I feel like I've been circling this mountain for a long, long time. I just got to enact it. I just got to go for it. Listen, change is coming. Changes are coming. It's exciting to me for change, to see what God's going to do. So many people are fearful of change, but listen, if your life hadn't been changed, you'd be headed for hell. It's not a fearful thing. Your life is a good thing for change to come. Because if you move forward, things are going to change. Hopefully you're going to change your clothes. It's not a fearful thing. Hopefully you're going to change your socks and stuff. Okay? Hopefully. I praise the Lord that maybe you will. Because change is not an awful thing, it's a good thing. How many have ever changed your sheets and then laid on them and said, just feels good to lay on clean sheets, don't it? I love it when that one changes them just before we go to bed. You know, it's like, yeah, I changed it. But she does, but she doesn't like the way I do it because it's not, you can't like bounce a quarter on her. Okay, and so, he didn't even do that right. And so anyway, it worked. But anyway, I just love to lay on it. Get off of it, you're wrinkling it. We're going to bed. Chances are pretty good it's going to get wrinkled. You know? I'm not going to lay there like a board. You know, but I love that smell and that freshness. It's the same thing when God brings change in your life. It's like new sheets on a bed. You can lay there and go, man. Especially in the wintertime. I like my room cold when I sleep. Okay? And you get there and she pulls them out of the dryer and puts them on the bed and they're warm and the room's cold. Oh, yeah. Get off of them, you're wrinkling them. You know, that's the best, man. It's the best. So, when God changes your sheets, don't start digging out the old ones. Because He's changed them and they're fresh and they're new. And you can lay there and you can just say, God, thank you for moving me. Because I didn't know what else I was going to do. But change is a good, good thing. Don't look at change as negative. Change is positive. Change is coming. If God wanted you to stay the same, He'd have never brought you here. If God wanted you to be just like you were 5 years ago, you'd have never been here. 5 months ago, you'd have never been here. 5 weeks ago, you'd have never been here. But God is trying to move you somewhere. Listen, it is so exciting to watch those that have been overworked and underappreciated. And you know who you are without me asking, without me looking at you or calling your name. You know who you are. I don't want to get away from you. For so many years, you've been overworked and underappreciated, and you're starting to get help. Don't push back against the help.
Amen.
I'm going to look down, okay? Because God is trying to raise up another generation, somebody else that can do what it is that you've been doing by yourself for so long. And you've cried out to God and said, God, listen, I know this. Don't you lie and say, oh, I never said that. Listen, you're praying and you say, I don't know if I can do this today, God. I don't know if I can do this another day because I just volunteered to help. And all of a sudden, it's my job every week. I just volunteered to help. And all of a sudden, I don't have any help to do this. God, I don't know. I'm tired. God has heard your prayer and He has brought people into your life. Don't kick against what God is trying to do in your life. Just say, hey, come on, let me show you how to do this. Let me help you. Let me show you what we need to get done. Let me show you how we're going to do this. Let me help you. And then see, what happens is you have somebody else to take that spot that you can abuse and underappreciate. Okay, and so then they have an obligation. Yeah. We have an obligation to train and to teach and to disciple another generation. Yeah. Ooh, dear God in heaven. Boy, it gets quiet when you start talking about this stuff. Why? I don't understand why we fight against correction, why we fight against instruction. I don't understand it. I try to be better all the time. I'm constantly doing leadership stuff. I'm constantly doing classes on stuff. I want to be better. I don't want to be like I am today and next month. I want to be better at what I do next month. I'm not going to get offended if somebody teaches me something that I'm doing wrong and say, you need to do it this way because I've been down this road and this is where this road leads. You need to get over here and do it this way, and I'm telling you, it'll work every time. But we cannot kick against help.
Amen.
I'm pretty confident that if God's going to do what God says He's going to do here, we're going to need help. I don't mean to burst your bubble, but 8 people can't handle 160 kids much longer. You're welcome, Cody. April, Amy, you're welcome. Trying to help. Just trying to be a blessing. You're talking, ain't what I said, so it's all right. Here we go. Just trying to be a blessing. The vision. The vision is greater than the few.
Amen.
The vision that God has given me is not for just a few people. But it is for the many. The few have just a few people. That's why they set them down in tens and fifties, hundreds. Because the few can only handle the few. But the many can handle the many. Listen, I can't do everything that I need to do. And you can't do everything you need to do if we're running around. Don't know if we're washing or hanging out. We're running around. We don't know what's supposed to be going on or who's what, doing what, what's going on. It's time for us to let other folks step up. Remember, I spent like 2 months ago, I asked you to open your heart and let more people come. I stood right here on this pew. I think I stood on the pew. And I asked you to please open your heart and let more people hear what God's doing in your life. Listen, there's I went to Black church a lot when I was younger. And I say younger, when I was in my 20s. And oh, that's younger. But there's there's a new Lima Baptist, and a lady stood up. She said, "Let me tell it, because nobody can tell it like I can tell it." And she began to tell her testimony of what God had done for her. Don't you understand, church, that there can't nobody tell your story like you can tell your story?
Yeah.
Nobody can tell the story like you can tell the story.
Yeah.
Nobody can tell anybody what God's done for you like you can tell what God's done for you.
Yeah.
Don't you understand that it's your time? It's your time. Listen, the preacher once said this, and I don't know the quote. I know the quote, but I don't know who quoted it. He said, "I preach the gospel every day, and I use words when necessary."
Yeah.
What does that mean? That means I live it every day. I show my life every day that it's the gospel of Jesus Christ, and I use words when I have to. Because, listen, somebody somewhere is crying out, needing God in their life. They're calling out, trying everything they can to find God in their life, trying to find any answer they can find, and they're looking for something real. And we stand there and say, well, you know. So my question is, do you really believe what we say we believe? What do you mean, Brother Jeff? This is what I mean. I'm so glad you asked. This can't just be our little church movement. Oh, God's just blessing me. Oh, hallelujah. But when I walk out of here, do I really believe what I say I believe? In the middle of the grocery store, am I able to grab somebody's hand and pray for them and not be embarrassed? Well, if you'll go outside, I'll pray with you. Are you able to call somebody on the phone because God began to deal with you? I just want to pray with you. Can you pray with them over the phone? And do you really believe that God's going to touch them? Or is it just something good to amen? Something for the preacher to preach? So do we really believe what it is that we say we believe? Do we really believe that Jesus is the Son of God?
Yes.
Do we really believe that He was crucified?
Yes.
Do we really believe that by the blood, by His stripes, I am healed? Yes. By that blood that pulled off of His toe and dropped onto that ground, I am healed by those stripes? Or do we really believe that? We have a hard time with that one. We can believe that He was laid in a borrowed tomb. We can believe in the third day He rose. We can believe that He ascended to the Father. We can believe that He's making intercession. We can believe that I'm saved because I believe in Him. We can believe that. We have a hard time believing that He really, really, really heals.
Amen.
We have a hard time believing that He'll meet our financial need. I'm just a living testimony of what God will do financially for you. I'm not a rich person at all. But can I share with you, this is what I am. I'm a blessed person. I'm blessed beyond measure. I'm blessed. God's better to me than I deserve. I'm very blessed. But the problem is that people start looking to the church for their source. And your church is not your source. God is your source. God is your source, not the church. The church is here to be a blessing to you, truly. The church is here to help you, yes. The church is here to be all it can be for you and everything that we need it to be. That's what the church is here for. To teach you, to train you, to help you, to bless you. That's what we're here for. To teach you how to live for God. That's why we're here. But we are not your financial source. Well, that went over good. Boom, right there. God is your source. God is your blesser. But I prayed and God didn't. Listen. I'm talking about getting serious with God. Serious, not I prayed a prayer. It's not your tears that make you serious. It's not your need that makes you serious. It's when you believe that God is greater than your problem that gets you serious. When you know greater, when listen, whenever you know that God is greater than your problem. Please quit switching to answer other person. Whenever you know that God is greater than your problem, that's when God can begin to deal with you. That's when God can begin to do those things. That's when God can start messing with you. That's when God can start getting you to where He needs you to be. That's when God can start building your faith. That's when God can start getting you to where He needs you to be. But listen, as long as we never give God a chance, as long as we never give God a chance because we look for somebody else to meet our need. Okay? I've been there with nothing in the bank and a minus. I've been there. No, listen, no savings account. Nothing. No money to get from anywhere. There is none. There's no change left in the couch. There's nothing left in the ashtray. There's no dollars stashed. There is no free week. There is nothing. I've been there. I understand where you're at. I've been there. But I don't believe that. I don't care what you believe. You can't tell it like I can tell it. Because you ain't been there like I've been there. Hear me. And all of a sudden, out of the blue, somewhere, somehow, God shows up. And He uses people to show up. And somebody somehow hears from God. Somebody somehow knows that there's a need to be met. And on the next thing you know, somebody walks up and gives you $50 or $20 or $100. Well, that's never happened to me. That's because you never believed in God for it. You never trusted that God's going to take care of it. So we don't let God be God.
Yeah, that's right. Come on.
Had it happen more than one time because it took me a little while to understand what God was trying to do in my life. And then we got it. We've got it. I don't know. I don't remember a specific date. But I remember the conversation I had with Bill Parsons on the phone. We were late on some payments. We were doing things in the church. We were doing whatever we were doing. I don't know what we were doing at that time. We were doing stuff. We were living for God. We trusted God. We were doing whatever we could do. But we hadn't gotten it yet. The last conversation I had with Bill Parsons that I remember was this. I apologize that it's late. It'll never be late again. It'll never be late again. And I hung the phone up and I said, God, I'm sick of this. I'm sick of it. I'm not going to live my life being some broke, poor little Pentecostal preacher. That's not disrespectful. I didn't say it. I didn't shake my fist at God. But I talked to God like He was my Father. I need You to teach me how to do this. And you know what I did? I got two more jobs. Because God opened the door for it. I was anointed, but I had to go wash some sheep. You know what it taught me? That God will open doors and not always just pour money on you, because I couldn't have handled it had He just poured money on me. But I worked. I'm going to cuss right here, ready? Work. And so here we go. I worked for 2 years. I had three jobs for 2 years. Well, that's not an answer to prayer. Yeah, I was. Never was late again. Never have been since. Never had another broke day in my life. You can say what you want to say. Everybody wants God to rain $100 bills in their mailbox. No. That doesn't happen all the time. Sometimes He opens up a door. But I ain't gonna just gonna work all the time. Then be broke. But don't come begging the church. Be broke. If you're not with... Oh, that went over good, didn't it? If God opens up a door for you to have a job and you need money, chances are pretty good you need to fill that job. I know that's not popular preaching. You're supposed to give me $100 in the offering, which you're supposed to get $10,000 back. I know. Okay? But maybe God will open up a door for you to get $10,000 by you working for a full year.
Amen.
I'm just saying. That's all I can tell you. See, we want God to just pour out blessing on us without having to do anything. But David said, I'll not give God something, cost me something. Because they were going to give Him the threshing floor. And He said, you ain't giving me nothing. I'm going to pay for it. Because I'm not giving God something that cost me something. Things that cost you things are more precious to you. And it's a lot harder to get rid of. Because to give something, you have to think about it. It has to go through your mind. What am I able to give? Then it has to go through your will. Am I willing to give? Then it has to go through your flesh. Am I willing to let go of it? So to give, you have to go through your mind, your flesh, and your will. So, when we give it to the Lord, this is not on my... You're welcome. Okay. But when you give to the Lord, it's not about the dollars. It's about the ability to let go of what God's given you. We always say, we always think of it this way. How much of my money can I give? The real question is, how much of God's money can I keep? Because God gave it to me. I earned it. Yeah, genius. He gave you the mind to do it. He gave you the body to work. He gave you the ability to do your job. He gave you everything that He's given you. He gave you the health to go to work. He's given you the ability to get to work. He's done all these things for you. So how much of God's money can I keep? Not how much of my money can I give. I wouldn't even preach this yet. This is another series I was going to start. I wouldn't even preach this yet, but I got to throw it out there. Okay, I'm trying. The vision, I'll get back on this. The vision is greater than the few. The vision includes the many. I know that, listen, I know that's not popular preaching, but it's the truth.
Amen.
And I'm not going to get up here and hip-haw around about it. We got to go to work.
Amen.
If you want me to get that, you want me to prove that to you, we'll go to Haggai right now and I'll prove to you how God's house was in disarray. And everybody else got nice houses. And God said, if you're not going to bless my house, y'all ain't going to have nothing. I'll prove that to you here in a minute. The Jesus plan. Let's go to the Jesus plan. I'll leave you alone. I've heard you enough. Let's go to the Jesus plan. Luke 5:27-31. Luke 5:27-31. Luke 5:27-31. Hallelujah. Thank you. And after these things, he went forth and saw a publican named Levi sitting at the receipt of custom. And he said unto him, follow me. And he left all, rose up, and followed him. And Levi made him a great feast in his own house. And there was a great company of publicans and others that sat down with him. But their scribes and Pharisees murmured against his disciples, saying, why do you eat with and drink with publicans and sinners? And Jesus answered unto him, they that are holy, not a physician, but they that are sick. He called them, follow me. The Jesus plan, help me. I need you to help me. And the first thing that Matthew did was prepare a feast for him. The first thing that he did was, God, Jesus has called me. I'm going to give him something. Jesus called me to a greater mission. I've got to give him something. I'm going to prepare a great feast for him. I'm going to give him what I can give him. He doesn't need money. Everybody acts like Jesus is some poor preacher with holes in his robes. And had a sandal put together with tape, with duct tape. And they looked like a bunch of hobos running around. The boy went on over 10 minutes and they're chasing him down with gold. Do you think God's going to put his son in a world with the economics, an economic world without anything? I don't think so. So gold and silver, it didn't interest Jesus. But Matthew, what he could give him was a dinner. I can bless you with a dinner. I can give you something. And so he gave him something. He said, listen, here's what I want to do. Here's what I want to do. I'm going to come to my house. You call me to greater. Come to my house. I'm going to make a feast for you. I'm going to do this thing for you. I'm going to bless you. And so Jesus came, and then all the church folks got mad because Jesus went to the sinner man's house.
Yes. Yeah.
And I love Jesus. He said, you guys are nuts. Those that are sick need a physician, not you.
Right.
Those that don't know anything about God, those that don't know about the Word of God, they're the ones that need a physician, not somebody who's supposed to know. They're not, listen, because the Jesus plan is he called them. I need your help. Number two, he met with them. Matthew chapter 9, verse 10. And it came to pass as Jesus said at meat in the house, behold, many publicans and sinners came and sat down with his disciples. Verse 11. And when the Pharisees saw it, they said to the disciples, why eateth their master with publicans and sinners? But when Jesus heard that, he said unto them, they that be holy, not a physician, neither account of the same thing, but they that are sick. So Jesus called them, and then he had the audacity to go meet with them where they lived. How dare the Son of God be somewhere where the Son of God is needed? How dare him go sit down with folks that don't know anything about him and sit down and say, this is what I'm going to do with you. And he met with them. So number one, he called and beckoned to them and said, would you please come help me? Number two is, I'll meet you wherever you're at. I'll meet you wherever you're at. The third one is, he taught them. He taught them his way in Mark chapter 6. Verse 34, he taught them the way he wanted things done. Mark 6:34. Ethan, I apologize for not giving these to you. I'm going to try to get better at that. I apologize for that. And Jesus, when he came out, saw much people and was moved with compassion toward them because they were as sheep not having a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. So number one, he called them and said, will you help me? Number two, he met them. He met with them and ate with them. Let me just share a little bit of Hebrew history with you. I'm not a Hebrew scholar, but I do know a little bit. Whenever you ate with somebody, it wasn't like, hey, let's go to Mazzio's after church, like we did. Okay? It was an event. You didn't ask just anybody to come to your house. You didn't ask just everybody to come eat with you and share your table. It was a special honor to be asked to go to anybody's house and eat. It was a special honor given to a special person to come to their house, and it was an event. That's why you'll see, like when Jesus was eating and Mary Magdalene washed his feet with her tears and dried his feet with her hair. It was an event. It was a special occasion. It was something that wasn't just like we do. You know, let's go to McDonald's and hang out. It wasn't like that. We eat just for the sake of eating, whether we're hungry or not. But it was a special cold occasion for Jesus to be at Matthew's house. And for Matthew to do this great and mighty meal for them was a great thing. And for the Pharisees, that's why it was such a big deal. That's why the Pharisees showed up. It was a big deal. Okay? So understand where it's coming from. So when he called them, then Matthew said this, "I'm going to do something great for you." And Jesus accepted an invitation to come eat at somebody's home who he knew was a sinner. He knew that he was a publican, a tax collector. He knew what the church people would say about him, but he didn't care because he had a relationship to build there. And so he called Matthew. Then he went and ate with Matthew in Matthew's house. And then he began to teach them many things. Because when this is the Jesus plan, I'll call you, I'll meet you where you're at, and if you'll let me, I'll teach you how to do this.
Yeah.
Verse the fourth one. He sent them to minister. I call it different things. But I set my plan at the Jesus plan. What do you mean, Brother Jeff? Okay, meds. I'm going to motivate you, I'm going to educate you, I'm going to disciple you, and send you. Jesus, follow me. Motivated them to follow. Taught them, educated them, discipled them, sit down with them, and then sent them. It's the same thing, I just call it different stuff. I call it 21st century stuff. But it's still the same plan. Our church is built on the Acts church plan. What is that? Fellowship, eating, discipleship, and hanging out with each other. That's the truth. That's what I did. I went to the book of Acts and said, how do they build this church? And that's what they did. And I said, if it's good enough for them, it's good enough for us. That's the plan. This is the Jesus plan. And Jesus saw them. And Jesus, when he came out, saw much people. Oh, I didn't tell you that verse today. I sent them, Luke 9 and 2. I don't know if that's right or not. I think it is. Luke 9 and 2. It's 7, you can't read your own writing. Luke 9 and 2. That's it. Thank you. And he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. In 20 seconds. I think the reason the devil fights healing so bad is because it's connected to the kingdom of God.
Yes.
What do you mean? The kingdom of God. He preached the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. They're connected. Conjunction. Thank you. Looking up words and making them run right? Conjunction, what is your function? Okay. For y'all young people, y'all don't know, y'all miss that.
That's right.
Yeah. Y'all got some stupidness going on. We had Schoolhouse Rock. Taught me lots of stuff. Okay? Couldn't wait. Out of the frying pan and into the fire. Cut loose the sandbags, but the balloon wouldn't go any higher. Okay, here we go. Sorry, I had flashbacks. All right. And he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. Verse 3. And he said unto them, take nothing for your journey, neither staves nor scrip, neither bread, neither money, neither have two coats apiece. And whatsoever house ye enter into, there abide, and thence depart. Last one. And whosoever will not receive you when you go into that city, shake off the very dust from your feet for a testimony against you. What did he do? He sent them out. He sent the 12 out. It's verse 1, I believe he talks about the 12. Go to verse 1 for me. Then he called his 12 disciples together and gave them power and authority over all devils and to cure diseases. Verse 2. Go back to verse 1. I'll do this, I'm sorry. Scotty, I'm sorry, but go ahead. Okay. Power and authority over all devils and to, it's more than a band, cure diseases. Okay, go to verse 2. Heal the sick. Said it twice. Why? Because it's connected to our faith. It's connected to our faith. I can believe all day that I'm saved, but I have a hard time believing that I'm healed. Why? Because we don't see it in operation. We see people come down and get saved. We see people say that they're saved and they're living for God. We see that, but we don't see what we don't see. I want to see this so bad. This is what I want to see. Some dude with no arm, pop, there's an arm there.
Amen.
I want to see that.
Amen.
I want to see blinded eyes open.
Amen.
I want to see diabetes be eradicated.
Amen.
But why don't we see? Because we don't believe it. We can believe that we're healed, sick. I mean, we can believe that we're saved, but we can't believe the healing. And I'm not saying don't go to the doctor. Please don't walk out of here. That preacher said don't go to the doctor. I didn't say that. I don't care if you go to the doctor. My goodness, go. Doctors do great things now.
Yeah.
But as you're going to the doctor, say, I'm going to be healed in the name of Jesus. I believe for my healing. Listen, I'm not going to quit doing what the doctor tells me until I'm healed. But I'm going to be healed in the name of Jesus. And people say, well, that doesn't work. That hasn't worked. That hasn't worked. Is your statement of faith greater than what you're feeling? When it becomes greater than what I feel, then that's when it works. It doesn't work whenever I give my pain precedent over my faith. Okay, how can I say it this way? I don't deny it's there, but I'm not going to give it the right to set up a camp there.
Amen.
It's not. It doesn't. We don't have to let it set up a dwelling place in us. And I'm not saying you're weak or you're horrible. I'm not saying that. Listen, I got two issues in my body right now. I need healed. And I'm believing God every day that it's going to be done. It's going to be healed. Now, I'm not dying anything. No, I'm not. Okay, made some of y'all mad. Okay, I'm not dying, but they just need to be taken care of. My wife has an issue; she needs taken care of, and we're trying to figure this thing out. We're learning. Amen.
Amen.
If God can teach me how to be financially blessed, He can teach me how to be healed.
Amen.
And I want to learn. I'm not going to be offended if God said, "Look, you idiot. This isn't how you do this. You do it this way." I'm looking, I'm trying, I'm studying Scripture. Listen, I spent 8 hours down here yesterday, and it wasn't all for this. I got some stuff I'm working on for me. I got some stuff I need to figure out and work out and study out and read out, pray out, faith out. I got some stuff I gotta handle. And so I'm down here seeking God for my wife and for us and some stuff that's going on. I wasn't just down here just preparing. I had the message prepared. I was ready. But I had to come down here and get some stuff done. I had to tear a wall down. I had stuff to do. Okay. But the 12, he sent out, the original 12, he sent out, go preach the gospel. Go preach the kingdom of God and heal the sick. Cure the diseases. And Luke 10 and 1. This is the last one, Ethan. 10 and 1. Thank you, sir. After these things, the Lord appointed other 70 also. So it's not just for the 12.
That's right.
I hate to blow your doctrine out of the water.
Yeah.
But it wasn't just for the 12. And the other 70 also sent them two and two before his face every city and place without. And he sent them two and two before his face into every city and place, whither he himself would come. Verse 2. Therefore said he unto them, the harvest is truly plenty, truly great, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he would send forth laborers unto the harvest. I don't mean to mess up with your theology. But a lot of folks think that the healing died with the apostles, the 12. What about the 70? And what about praying for others who would come and labor for the harvest? That's what the scripture says. I don't care what some slick haired shiny shoe preacher said. What does the scripture say? I don't care what some old white dude said. What does the scripture say? Somebody didn't have faith or didn't know how to be healed. What did they say? I don't know. But what does this say? Verse 1, one more time. After these things, the Lord appointed other 70 also, and sent them two and two before his face into every city and place whither he himself would come. He said, go to these cities because I'll be there. Verse 2. Therefore said he unto them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Pray ye, therefore, the Lord of the harvest, that he would send forth laborers unto his harvest, into his harvest. What does that mean? That means that we are to look up and notice that the harvest is truly ready for harvest. And pray that we have help. Pray that we can let go of some things so somebody else can grab hold of it. Pray that we can release something so we can concentrate on this area and not, but we can do this. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Spinning plates and juggling. I'm just trying to get us to a point where we understand. Listen, you 10% that have done everything for years and years and years, and that's all you know how to do, we're going to have to let go of some stuff. You don't think it's hard for me to let go of stuff? You don't think that I have a hard time letting go of stuff? I do. But look around you. There's not 40 people here anymore. You don't have to do everything. You know what's a cool thing? This is what I found. This is really cool. And I just one day it just hit me as I was leaving, and I wasn't the last one to leave. I don't have to be the last one all the time anymore. Amen? Mark and Doris did. Let them do their job. Let them, everybody else go. Let them go check everything and lock up. They can do it. They have keys and everything. Click. They can do it. The reason being is in case somebody's hiding out in the back and wants to steal everything in the church. Let them be the last ones that walk through. So they know everybody else is gone. Serious. Because then they know they're the only two in the house, right? And so if they hear somebody in the back, they're pretty confident it's not one of them. Okay? It's a ghost. That's all they said. But the doors ain't going back there. Mark, there's something back there. Okay. We'll let them do their job. I just use them for example. Whatever. Fill in the blank. Whatever somebody's position or job is, let them do it. Because I don't have to stay here and do it anymore, and I love it. It's a nice thing to drive off and there's cars in the parking lot. That's a cool thing. And it's just one day it struck me. As we were driving, and I don't even know who locked up. I didn't know if Mark and Doris locked up or whoever locked up. I didn't care. Because Brother Turner just say, I'm leaving, and just walk off. Whether anybody had keys or not. Did he not? I'm going home. Didn't know if he didn't care. He just left. Somebody take care of it. And we always took care of it. Well, sometimes we took care of it. There's more than one time the door was open. And that's the truth. You could have just gotten anything you wanted. Good. God protected us. I said all this to say this. We're moving forward quickly. Quickly. When things of God start falling into place, they fall quickly. Well, I'll give you an example. Your greatest defeat can turn into your greatest achievement. What are you talking about? David, not this David, the King David, should have been at war when it was the time for the kings to be at war, but he was checking out Bathsheba, taking a bath. He was on the internet. Yeah. Checking out Bathsheba. Killed her husband. Her husband was being more of a man than the king was being. I ain't going on. I ain't sleeping with my wife. We got people out in battle. I ain't going on. I'll sleep in the front door. So David had to have him killed. David had to cover up a pregnancy. That baby was born and died. David laid on his face on the ground and fasted and sought God, and the baby died. That's where we would quit. God didn't answer my prayer. I fasted, I prayed, I cried, I did all these things, and God didn't answer my prayer the way I wanted it answered. That's where we would quit. I knew there wasn't nothing, just God thing. But it was also David who went into his wife Bathsheba, and they had a son who was the smartest man, the wisest man to ever live. His name was Solomon. So his greatest defeat turned into his greatest victory. So just because it doesn't happen like you think it ought to happen, just because you think that everything you have it in your head the way I should do everything, and that's just how people are. We make plans. This is how God should do this. This is how God should do this. This is how God should do this. I know. I had a dream. Can I tell you something about everybody that has a vision every day? You don't. Those are specific things for specific people. Sorry, spiritual people. Your vision, their vision, everywhere, vision. Yeah. Those are specific things that God gives people for people. I believe in that. Everybody has a word all the time for you. They got one for everybody else too. We get these letters in the mail. We used to, not so much anymore. We used to get these letters. Pastor, I got a word for your church. It's a form letter. They sent to every other church. Really? Thank you. We love you. Well, I had a word. Listen. No. No. Listen, I'm not a know-it-all, but I'm a know-it-something. And I know when God begins to deal with me, I know when God says, chunk it. Got it. But hear me. When God begins to do things quickly, when God begins to do things, things happen quickly. The baby died. Then boom, here we go. Solomon's born. Then here we go. The wisest man that ever lived. Here we go. Solomon's built the temple of God. Amen? If you read in Haggai, the people who remembered Solomon's, the temple of God, when Solomon built it, they looked at the one they had and they were so distraught. They were weeping and moaning and throwing themselves on the ground because it looked like trash to them because Solomon built a real one. You can read your Bible. That's what it says. And they were so upset. And that's when you get the scripture that says that the former will be, I'm sorry, the new, the, what is it? Latter will be greater than the former. The latter blessing will be greater than the former blessing. It may not look like much, but the blessings of God are in it. Because I was going to read some of that to you, but I'm running out of time. But I was going to read some of that to you about how God said, let's just read it. Haggai 1, I think it's only two verses. Two chapters, I mean. Haggai 1 and about 6, I believe it is. try to get there. Go back to 5, Brother Ethan. That's where we'll start. Now therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. You have sown much and bring in little. You eat, but you have not enough. You drink, but you're not filled with drink. You clothe you, but there is none warm. All right, mercy. The King's English gets me, I'm telling you. And he that earneth wages to put it into bags with holes. Verse 7. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Twice. Verse 8. Go up in the mountain, bring wood, and build the house, and I will take pleasure in it, and I will be glorified, saith the Lord. Verse 9. You looked for much, and lo, it came to little. And when you brought it home, I did blow upon it. Why, saith the Lord of hosts, because of my house is in waste, and you run every man into their own house. Therefore the heaven over you is stayed from dew, and the earth is stayed from her fruit. Keep on. And I call for a drought to be upon the land, upon the mountains, upon the corn, upon the new wine, upon the oil, upon that which is in the ground, which the ground bringeth forth, and upon men, and upon cattle, and upon all labor of the hands. Keep on. And Zerubbabel the son of Shealtiel, and Joshua the son of Josedech, the high priest, with all the remnant of the people, obey the voice of the Lord their God and the words of Haggai and the prophet as the Lord their God had sent him. And the people did fear before the Lord. Now listen, check this out. Verse 13. Then spake Haggai the Lord's messenger in the Lord's message unto the people, saying, I am with you, saith the Lord. Why? Hang on. Why? Because they heard the word of the Lord. If you read all that, you can read it all on your own. I'm not going to keep you here forever and preach this to you. But I want you to hear this. He said, consider your ways. Because you've not done these things, I'm going to do these things. Consider your ways. He said, this is what's going to happen. You're going to work, and it's going to come to naught. I'm going to stay everything. You're not going to have. Why? Let's go to verse 14, I believe it is. And the Lord stirred up the spirit of Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, I think that's right, governor of Judah, and the spirit of Joshua, the son of Josedech, the high priest, and the spirit of all the remnant of the people. And they came and did work in the house of the Lord of hosts, their God. Verse 15, and I'll leave you alone. In 24th day of the sixth month, in the second year of Darius the king. Sorry, 16. That's just a calendar.
That's it.
Six. All right, we'll go to the next chapter then. That's another calendar. Speak now, Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, the governor of Judah, and to Joshua, the son of Josedech, the high priest, and to the residue of the people, saying, verse 3. Who is left among you that saw the house in their first glory? And how do you see it now? Is it not in your eyes a comparison as nothing? What it's saying is this. You've seen it. Yeah. Now it looks like nothing to you. You remember the old, and it seems like nothing to you. But here's what I'm going to share with you. I promise I'll quit. We start seeing things quickly when God begins to move. Yeah. What do I mean by that? That God, when He begins to step out and do things, when we begin to step out of what God's doing, God begins to move quickly on our behalf. We have got to understand that when things begin to fall, they're like dominoes. When things of God begin to fall, it's like dominoes. You can't stop it unless you move a domino. And then you're liable to knock down another domino. And so when they begin to fall, they fall quickly because God, when God moves swiftly. God waits on us to be prepared, and when we get prepared, He moves quickly. But he can't move us where we're not ready to go. That makes sense. Y'all with me?
Yes.
Okay. So you can read all that. It's two chapters. It'll take you 15 minutes to read it. And read what God did. When God said, if my house is in disrepair, I will not bless you. But when they began to work on the house of God, God began to bless them beyond measure. The wall being gone is not the last or the first thing that's going to happen. It's not the last thing that's going to happen. We're going to change some things. Why? Because this is the house that God has given us. If we started building a new building today, it'd be 8 months to 9 months before it ever built. We have money in reserve for this building. We have an account just for this building. So, when you come back next week, probably something else different. Come back Wednesday, probably something else different. Why? Because we have to maintain and do what God's called us to do here. Here. This is God's house. Whether we think it's beautiful or not, the how did that saying go? Now the latter will be greater than the former?
Yeah.
I always get it backwards. The latter glory will be greater than the former glory. Just because it's not, look, when we look at the church, our church building, don't get distracted by the church building. What's going on in the inside of it? What's God doing? What is he doing? It was just a box overlaid with gold. But in the inside was the power of God. Stand to your feet with me. I'm not done.